And so today marks the third episode in a Journey Through Azure Serverless series. And today's session is on Azure's data platform, building serverless applications. So as with all sessions in this series, this will run over the next 30 minutes. And whilst you are muted, you are able to engage in the chat function and ask any questions that you have throughout in that chat box. We'll be monitoring it throughout. So please do get involved as much as possible. This session is being recorded and it will be available to watch on demand. I'll post a link into the chat of where you can access that. So before we get started, just want to quickly run over the Microsoft Reactor's Code of Conduct. Like with every session that we run, it's just really important for people to have a quick look at this and understand that it is an inclusive environment and friendly environment that we have throughout these sessions, and really just to be aware of one another, respectful to everyone. And if we do see any kind of differences of opinions, just to be really understanding of those differences that we might see. Our speaker for this series is Eldert, who we are welcoming back again. So really delighted to have Eldert with us. And Eldert is a Azure MVP and technology lead at Motion 10. And we'll hear from him just shortly. As I mentioned, we're in episode number 3 of this series. So our first week, we looked at an introduction to Azure Serverless. Last week was Azure's integration platform. And this week, then, we're looking at Azure's data platform. And so like I mentioned, I'll share the link to any on-demand videos in the chat thread. So with all of that said, I will hand over to Eldert to get us started.
Thank you. So yes, first of all, welcome everyone. Thank you for being here today. I hope that everyone is doing well. So yes, today we are going to talk about Azure's data platform and how we can build a service application with that. Like indeed, it's the third episode in the series. And so what we will be showing today is, okay, so what are the options around the data platform and of course specifically as serverless? But first, a quick introduction. You might have already seen me in previous episodes of this series. I'm Eldert Groteboer. I come from Netherlands, where I work at Motion 10. I'm a technology lead, which basically means I do a lot of things around Azure and integration with our company. I'm an architect. I'm also Azure MVP, so I love to speak, I love to write, I love to blog. Basically everything that I can do with the community. And I'm also available on Twitter, of course. So if you have any questions, any remarks, just reach out to me and I will always respond back to you there. So let's have a look at the Azure Data Platform. So the Azure Data Platform, if you look, basically we can distinguish three pieces of what we want to do here. So we want to capture and manage data. So we have our data stores where we store our data, where we capture our data, where we manage our data. Then at some point we want to probably transform our data and analyze this. So we might do some transformations to different formats. We might start doing some analytics on this, start doing some machine learning on this. And finally, we are going to visualize this and make some decisions on top of this. So basically we have these three levels that we can distinguish. On the bottom are all data sources. So we can have relational databases like SQL. You can have non-relational data stores like Hadoop. We can have NoSQL databases, for example, like Cosmos DB. We can have streaming data, for example, where we go to event hubs, where you can have stream of data coming in. And of course, these can be both internal and external data stores that you can work with. Then on top of that, we have our transform and analyze. So once you have our data stored, we are going to do something with this. So we can orchestrate our data. We can extract it, transform it, load it to other places. So our ETL processes. We can do information management. So we can actually look at the data and see what kind of data is this. So we might do some things around, okay, is this GDPR data, for example? We can, of course, also stream those process those streams. So we can actually go over a stream of data and actually just see in the stream what's happening real time. So if we have a stream of data coming in, we could see, okay, what are the averages on this data that's coming in? Or do we see any outliers? All that kind of things. We can, of course, model our data. So probably if we are working with data, the data that's in our data store might not be the data that we actually want to work in with our applications. So we can model the data and then store it in different kinds of solutions there as well to make sure we actually have prepared data that we can then use in our applications. And finally, machine learning, of course, is all about understanding our data. So what's happening with our data? What do we see occurring? And can we actually learn from our data and, for example, do some predictive analysis? And finally, we as IT people, we love data that's in databases. We love to look at those rows and those JSON files. Our business users, maybe not though. Our business users will probably want to have this in a different way. So we are going to build applications on top of our data. And those applications are going to pull the data in and show this in a nice visual way. Or we can create reports out of this. So we can create reporting services where they actually get a report of saying, okay, so this is what happened over the last day, month, year. But reports that say, okay, this is actually what happened with our data. We can create dashboards, for example, using Power BI, where you can actually create nice graphs and nice visualizations, okay, what's happening in our organization? Or they might want to query the data. And for this, we might be using Excel with Power Query. And finally, we can bring this to mobile. So you can actually bring this data to your users in the palm of their hand, so they are always up to date with the latest status of their data. And at Motion 10, we like to use the 7-layer model for this. So basically what we have is we have 7 different layers. In every step of every layer, there's data in a different format. And of course, each layer also has their own tooling, their own services that we can use for this. First of all, we have our data sources. Now, data sources can be unstructured data. So for example, log files, just files in general, just JSON files, CSV files, AVRO files. It could be media, but this is just unstructured data. We don't know what's in here. We just know there's like a blob of data somewhere. Or it might be more structured data, like business applications or custom applications, where you have just data living there, maybe like in a database or something like that. The second layer is our data orchestration layer. And this is where we are going to say, okay, we are going to move our data around. So we're going to get the data from the data sources. We might do some transformations on this. We might do, and we're going to extract it, maybe do some transformations and load it to the next stage. And here we see tooling like Data Factory, like BizTalk, like Logicapps, like Synapse, of course. We are going to see Synapse in a lot of these pictures. But there's different tooling that we can actually do this like orchestration with and move the data around. And next place that we are going to load the data into is probably our data reservoir. And data reservoir is just a big lake, a big storage with all the data that we have in an unprepared format. So this is just the data from our data sources that we are going to bring together in this big data lake. And this might be data lake store, it might be Azure storage, it might be once again something like Synapse. But we are just going to store this and just have it in one place so we can later on use it for our different applications. We are going to prepare the data. So in our data reservoir, it's just our unprepared data, it's just as is. But probably once we are going to use data, we want to prepare it because we want maybe to have some specific fields or in different specific formats. So in this case, you're actually going to transform our data and in such a way that we can actually use it later on. And for this, you might be using things like Data Factory again, Databricks, Synapse, of course, but also things like for big data, HD Insight. So once again, we have different options here. Then we're going to put in the data storage where we can actually start using it. And here you'll see things like CosmosDB, things like SQLDB, or once again, of course, our Synapse environment. Then we are going to actually share the data. And for this, we might use something like Power BI Workspaces or Azure Data Catalog. But where we are just placing our data, okay, if you want data, here's the prepared data. It's in our models as we want it. And now you can actually start using this in your reports, in your dashboards, and things like that. And finally, actually the consumption of data. And this will, of course, be something like Power BI or actually your applications that will be using this. And these these 7 different layers together basically allow you to have your data in different stages of preparations and stages of usefulness. Now that we know, okay, which different options are there, let's have a look at the different serverless data services. Because of course we are in the serverless series here. So let's have a look on the data platform, which different options we have around serverless. So for all the different options I'm going to show today, almost all of them actually have a dedicated option and a serverless option. Well, of course, dedicated option, you just tell, okay, I want to have this amount of memory or this tier. I want to have this much RUs, for example, when we're going to talk about CompsonsDB, or I want to have this much storage for Azure SQL. So that's the dedicated option. But one we are going to look at today are, of course, the serverless options. And the serverless option with data basically mean we don't care anymore about how much storage do we need, how much compute do we need. We just push our data in and we'll just grow as needed. It will just give us compute power when needed and things like that. And so the first one we're going to look at is Azure SQL Database. And Azure SQL Database, as the name suggests, is just SQL. But in this case, it's SQL as a service. So just database as a service, I just tell them, I go to the Azure portal, I just say I want a new database. And just gives me a database and abstracts away the whole server around under it. The whole infrastructure is just abstracted away. Of course, we are talking about serverless, so we just provision it and pay as we go. And what's nice about Azure SQL Database, it actually will turn itself into turn itself off if we are not using it. So think about, for example, if you have a test environment where you might do a test like once every 2 or 3 days. Then you will just pay for your storage, of course, because if there's data in that, you will pay for the storage. But then once you start using the data, you only pay for those minutes that you're actually using this. And after a specified amount of time, like for example 1 hour, it will actually turn itself off again, and you're not paying for that compute power that's actually needed when you are doing queries or stuff like that. It's completely elastic, so if you put data in, it will just scale up, it will scale out. So if you have a high load, it will actually scale out. If you have a lot of data in there, it will scale up all automatically, and you don't have to think about these kind of things. It has automatic backups. You just say, hey, I want backups. I want them over here. It's completely automated for you. You can do geo-replication. So you can actually say, okay, instead of just having my data in one location, I want to have it in multiple locations. Then you can also decide, of course, like, do I want this like only in my own zone, or do I actually want like all over the world? You have the different options there as well. And finally, it's Azure SQL. So it's completely compliant, it's completely secure, it's completely auditable, meaning that you can actually see what's happening to your data. You can make sure that data is only available to those people that you actually want to be available to. You can use the built-in RBAC options on this, like you can give access to groups, you can give access to certain people. You can actually give access only to or deny access to certain fields, like you have row-based security, column-based security. So you really have all those options there. The next one is Azure Storage. So Azure Storage, of course, highly available, highly scalable. It's geo-redundant. So once again, you can say, okay, where do we want this, like zone or geo-redundant? I can say, do I want this to be read-only in geo or read-write in geo? And you have different options. So we have blobs, which basically does like binary data. We have disks, which you can use with your VMs to say, okay, I just want to store my VMs. Disks. You have tables where you have like key value pairs. And finally, we have queues, which is just, I put something in and on the other end, I can retrieve it again. So Azure Storage is one that you will always see in almost every solution, at least in my experience. Then we have Azure Cosmos DB. Azure Cosmos DB is a jack of all trades, basically. Like it's a document store, but with different options. First of all, it's elastically scalable. Once again, we are talking about serverless. So they have a serverless option as well, where you don't. With Azure Cosmos DB, you have request units. And request units is basically your strategy that will calculate how much do I pay for my resources. And so in the dedicated model, you will tell it like, okay, I want to have X amount of RUs, request units, and then you pay every month for those request units. The serverless options just actually gives you the request units dynamically. So if you have a high load, it will scale up the request units. If you have a low load, it will scale it down again. You can set boundaries, of course, like I want to have minimal like X RUs, maximum X RUs, but within that, it will actually scale up and down dynamically. It has guaranteed low latency, so it's like 99% of the requests will actually be below 10 milliseconds, so really low latency. It's global distributed, so actually with just like setting some check marks, I can say I want my data in these different locations. It will actually then replicate data between the different locations. For that, it has 5 consistency models, ranging from strong consistency, which you would use, for example, for financial data, where if you have multiple regions, you actually want to, if I make a transaction in a financial transaction, don't do anything with this transaction or with this part until it's replicated to all the different locations, up to eventual consistency. And that might, for example, be if I have a count of comments on a social media, that count, I don't really care. Like, I don't care about order or anything like that. And then there's 3 other ones in between, for example, session consistency for social media posts, where I don't really matter if someone else sees my post like 5 seconds later, but I still want to have that order and stuff like that. There's multiple data models and APIs, so you can do things like graph, you can do things like document stores, you can use SQL. So there's different, you have Cassandra, so there's different models, different APIs there. And finally, there's no schema or indexing required. Constantly take care of this. You choose a partition key, and by choosing the right partition key, partition strategy, you can actually have more efficient operations. So you do need to think about that. But the whole indexing and stuff like that is actually handled for you. So those are data stores. Now let's have a look at the processing. So the first one we're going to look at is Azure Data Factory. And Azure Data Factory, for those that remember SSAS, it's kind of like that. It's a data integration service. So you can move data around, you can do transformation, so you can do ETL or ELT, like you can extract from one location, do your transformations on top of this, load it to the next location, and there's different options out there. You have different connectors already out of the box, like 90 native connectors. You can also connect just to REST endpoints, so if there's not a connector out of the box, you can still consume your different services. And think about things like, of course, storage, Azure Storage, Azure Synapse, Azure SQL, but also think about things like AWS, S3 buckets, for example. It's a low code experience, so you can just drag and drop and create this by just configuration. And finally, of course, Azure Synapse integrated. Like Azure Synapse is actually like the big thing for Microsoft at the moment, so you'll see that basically everything at the moment is being connected to Azure Synapse. Of course, Azure Data Factory is not different, so you can actually push your data to Azure Synapse and start your analytics on top of that. Now, machine learning is very important at the moment. Like everyone wants to do machine learning because we're going to gain insights into our data. We want to learn from our data. We want to predict what's happening, going to happen from the data. So this is where Azure Machine Learning comes in. And Azure Machine Learning is data science and machine learning data service. So it's really, once again, serverless, but also very easy to get you started. It's a low code platform, so it's actually just drag and drop. So I just drag my shapes on there. I configure them. I can choose what type of models I want to use. And it's all very low level, very easy to get started with. Like I said, it's a drag and drop designer. So I just drag something on there. I configure it and I'm done. I don't need to write code if I don't want to. If I do want to, though, I can actually use Jupyter Notebooks and automated machine learning. So I can actually bring in some more power if I want to as well. And finally, it's MLOps is already built in. So I can just say, okay, here is my Git repository, push it to there and it will actually build all the pipelines for me. Once again, it's really easy to get started with. And so for someone like me, that's not like a machine learning guru, I still can use this to actually build my own machine learning models, actually start learning from our data. Next up, we have Azure Synapse. And like I said, Azure Synapse is really a really important topic within Microsoft at the moment. Synapse is actually the new version of what used to be Azure Data Warehouse, and is the modern data warehousing solution from Microsoft. So it's really about storing big amounts of data and start using analytics over that. Once again, they have a serverless and a dedicated option. We're going to talk about serverless one today, but they have both options here as well. And what I really like is they actually can do like data just on like, I push in a lot of data and I'm going to do analytics on top of that. But I can also do streaming capabilities. So I can actually just push with Event Hubs, I can push in a stream of data and have real-time analytics on top of the data together with my static data. And I can pull those two together and actually have all the different options from that. Now, of course, it's seamlessly integrated. What that means is you have basically different roles within Synapse. Like you have your people that are going to do the extract, transform, and load. Then you might have your data scientists that actually are going to do some ML on top of this. Then you might have your business analysts that are actually going to create reports. And they're all using the same Synapse Analytics workspace. So they have different views within that, different tooling within that. But they all are basically working in the same workspace. And what this means, they all are working on the same data within the same views and things like that. So you have a central point to actually manage that access because we have those different personas in there. So you have a central point where you manage that access. And it's not like everyone is working their own tool and they don't really know of each other what they are doing. Because they are now working together in this tool, it's also much more clear what is everyone doing and how does it impact over different stages of the data. Finally, there's built-in data integration. So like I just said with Azure Data Factory, you can use that. But there's also built-in data integration, which is actually like a lot of features of Azure Data Factory, plus some of their own features. So with that, we have now seen the different options that we actually can use. So let's have a quick demo on this. So in this demo, I'm going to use an order system, and this order system is going to create some data. So we are just getting a lot of orders in different stages, and I will just have something that is going to create this for me. But all these orders are being pushed to my Cosmos DB. And Cosmos DB, in this case, is where my order data store is. And so the nice thing about Cosmos DB, they have a change feed. And change feed basically allows you to to get an update whenever some item is created, updated, created or updated. Not deleted yet. I'm pretty sure at some point there might be something with this as well, but at the moment, just like creations and updates that we get. And it's a stream of data. So it's actually a log of data, just saying, okay, first this happened, then this happened, then this happened. And I can actually go back in time on this as well. So I can actually say, okay, I want to read from the start, or I want to read from a certain point, and just read that stream again. For this, you can use the event processor. I'm not going to go in too much details on this. I will actually share a session on this. But what we can do is actually set up an event sourcing strategy with this. So I'm going to use a function, and the function is going to read that change feed stream and going to actually process the data. Like I said, I will just go over this quickly, but I will share a video of myself and Olena Borshenko. That's where we actually did this for the Cosmos Conf that's currently happening. And I will share this link because you actually go into the whole event sourcing. So if you want to know more about that, you can watch that session. For now, I'm just going to go over this quickly. So we are going to get those orders into Cosmos DB. With the change feed processor, we are going to store them to SQL. So we are going to transform them, and we are going to store them in SQL. And on SQL, for example, we could then do some queries on, okay, how many people actually ordered, like from a specific region or something like that. And what we are going to do then is we are actually going to use Data Factory to get that data from Azure SQL. And we are going to do this once an hour. And what we are going to do is once an hour, we are going to create an order file with the data from that 1 hour and go to put that into blob storage. And later on, for example, you could then use something like Synapse to start doing analytics on top of that. We are not going to go that far today. We are going to just focus on this use case. I mean, I could talk for this for another 2 hours, but I don't have that much time anymore. So actually, let's just go to my demo for now. So we start in Cosmos DB, and we are going to go over here. So what I did, I created an order system function. And this is just going to create some dummy data for me. Like it's just going to create some orders. But what's most important for what I want to show you today here, I just have an HTTP trigger. So I'm going to call an HTTP endpoint. This endpoint is already running in Azure, by the way, so I can just call this in a second. But I have a Cosmos DB output. And what I love about functions is all these bindings that I have. So just by saying Cosmos DB, I specify my collection name, my database name, and my credential string. And then I'm done. I don't have to implement everything from the SDK. I just say I have this collection of orders. And I create some data in here. This code is, by the way, on my GitHub. I will also share this link later on. So if you want to have the code, look at the code, you can do that later on. Basically, I'm just creating orders with some random articles, and I'm adding them to this orders object. And because I'm doing this, once this finishes, it will just push out all those orders into Cosmos DB. Now, like I said, this is already running in Azure. I have HTTP triggers, so I have this endpoint over here. As you can see, it's my functions endpoint. It's on Azure website, so it's a function that's running already. I have this order system. I can now say, okay, I want to create, let's say, 1,000 orders. So let's send this in. It's now going to send this in. It's going to call my function. It's going to create 1,000 orders for me and then going to push those 1,000 orders to my CosmosDB. So while this is running, okay, it's now done. As you can see, I got 200 okay, so it's now pushed in to my CosmosDB. I can now go over to my orders container over here. I can grab my items, and if I refresh this, as you will see, there's now quite a bit of data in here. And if I open one of these, like let's just open one, like you see, it has an order number, it has an order status, it has some information about the customer, about the delivery, about the articles. So as you can see, there's some different information in here. And as you can see, there's just different information for different people and stuff like that. Now, like I said, we now have a change feed on this, and the change feed process is actually going to get this data. So this is already running as well, so it's already processing this. But just to quickly show you, this is another function. And for this one, I use the CosmosDB trigger. And this CosmosDB trigger actually just listens to that change feed. Once again, very easy to set up. I just provide some information about my containers. Once again, I have an output binding as well, for in this case for SQL. So I have an iCollector for SQL orders. And what I'm just going to do is I'm going to loop through all my orders coming in from my CosmosDB, and I'm then going to create a SQL order. And my SQL order is just about information about where is this coming from. So which order number, the order status, and then information about, okay, which customer and where does this customer live. And for example, I could create a dashboard on this, like saying, okay, so most of my orders are in this region or in this city or stuff like that. Now, like I said, it's already running, so it has already processed. So if I go back to my portal, I should actually be able to see in my SQL, if I run this, I should see that there's indeed some information in here. And just to show you, if I do a select count, let's just do unstar because that's easy for my DBL orders, just to show that indeed there's now 1,000 orders in here, or 1,010. So I already had 10 for my previous test, but so I just added 1,000 orders in there. So if I run this, I will see indeed there's some information about, let me just push this to the side, some information about the order number, the order ID, where was this located and things like that. And now we could actually start like pushing some dashboards or something like this on there. Like I said, we are not going to do that today. We are just going to focus on my single scenario. So next step in this one is we are going to store this information into a blob storage so we can then use it later on for our like big data queries and stuff like that. What we are going to do is use Data Factory for this. And if I go over to my Data Factory, I go over here to my Autoblade. As you can see, I have this data flow over here. Now, this is a very simple flow. In this case, I'm just pulling out all the lines for my SQL and push them into blob storage. If I wanted to, I could, of course, do some more things on here. Like I could start doing some selections. So I could actually start doing like aggregations on top of this. So for example, I could aggregate like all the orders for Berlin or something like that. I can filter out data, I can pivot data, I can do branching, I can do joins, I could actually pull out data from multiple sources. Like I said, this is something for another session. We are not going to focus on that today. We are just going to focus on our little our own scenario to say, okay, so I'm going to get data from our SQL database, going to put it in blob storage, so it's in nice cheap storage. And I can then just use the data analytics on top of that later on, for example, with Synapse. In this case, very easy. I just say, okay, all the data for my SQL database, I'm going to push to my blob storage. And this is very easy setup. I just like created a destination and a sync. I provide some information about, okay, what are the different options here. My data source is just my SQL database. And as you can see, this is very easy setup. It's all like configuration, very visual. So I can just drag things on here and just very easy set up. Now, like I said, this has already been running as well. Like it runs every once an hour, so it might not have done the one I just did now, but it has been running for a while already. So if I go over here, I should see for the 21st of today, there is the one already here. If I now go over here, I open this up, I can now download this, and then we can see if I open this. Actually, it did already get the data from that I just created. So as you can see, it does has all my different lines and just running all of these. And now I can do some data analytics on top of this. So I can now push this into my Synapse or whatever I want, and then start doing some analytics on this. However, for today, I'm already on time, I see, so let's get this wrapped up. So for today, we're almost done. But as you can see, with serverless, like I can just very easily like push this in. And now, like I now just pushed in 1,000 records into my SQL, I can now do some queries on this. But now, so I think I have mindset to time out after 1 hour. So in 1 hour, it will actually just turn my SQL off, like it will go into a sleeping state, and I don't pay for my processing anymore. Same for my CosmosDB. I push those in now, so my RUs are now built up because I just pushed in 1,000 records. But once I'm now done with this, it will actually scale down again to my lowest RUs. I think I set them to 400 or something like that. It will scale down again, and I only pay for like a very little, which is like for 400 RUs, like 20 euros per month or something like that. So all the different options I used are only pay as I go. So this is very nice, of course. So let's see a couple of takeaways on this. So scaling, like I said, it scales automatically. So when I push in, like now I pushed in 1,000 records, it will scale up for 1,000 records. I could also have set 1 million records or 10 million records. It would just have scaled up, it would have created RUs, it would have spun up all my different things. It would just have spun up automatically and scaled down again once I'm done with this. Very cost efficient. Like I said, my SQL is actually going to turn itself off. My CosmosDB is going to scale down. My data factory, I only pay if it's actually running. So I only pay for what I use. So of course I do pay for the storage. So if I have like 1 gigabyte, I pay for 1 gigabyte. If I have 10 gigabytes, I will pay for that. But I only pay for the storage, and storage is very cheap. And computation, I only pay for when I'm actually running something like queries or stuff like that. And of course, as always, choose the right service for your scenarios. So I just showed you my scenario where I just like use CosmosDB for my orders, like in a NoSQL format. I then extract something out of this, I push it into SQL format, and then I get that out again and just push it as blob. So those are three different scenarios that I have there already. So make sure you use the right services for your scenario as well, and combine them together to actually create that end-to-end scenario. So with that, I would like to say thank you. Once again, if you want to know more, I will be publishing my code, I will be publishing my slides. So if you want to have a look at that, it will be on my GitHub, which I will share in a second. If you want to know more about event sourcing, I will share our session on that. If you want to get started with it yourself, please visit Microsoft Learn and LearnTV. There's a lot of information about serverless, about all different services I showed you today. So if you want to get started on this yourself, please have a look at that. Join the Reactor community. I love the Reactor. I really hope we can go there in person soon. They have some very nice locations, so look for a Reactor in your neighborhood. And once we can open up again, we can actually go there. I would love to see you there at some point. And with that, I would like to say thank you. If you have any questions, please put them in the chat. I will have a look there. If you have questions later on, you can always contact me, either Twitter, email, or LinkedIn. So feel free to contact me there. I will always respond. And let's have a look if there's any questions in the chat. So just let me scroll up. So let me see. Okay. Just realized server as SQL, was it different with SQL DTU scheme? Or does it work with serverless option only like in calculator? So with the DTU scheme, you actually specify how many DTUs you want to have. So you specify, I want to have this many DTUs, and then you just know, okay, I'm going to pay X amount per month because I just pay for my DTUs. With serverless, you pay for what you use. So serverless, if I, for example, push in now 1 million records, I pay just for those 1 million records, so a bit for storage. I pay for my queries. So if I execute 10 queries, I pay for 10 queries. If I execute 10 million queries, I will pay for 10 million queries. And I basically pay for the compute I do on this. So that's the difference with DTU. With DTU, I just say I want to have this amount of resources. And DTU is very nice if I know, like, I already know how much transaction I'm going to have, how many queries I'm going to have. I can then just say, okay, I need this many DTUs, and I just know, okay, I'm going to pay this per month. Serverless is awesome if I don't know beforehand, like, For example, and if I'm going to have like once per month, I'm going to have a big load. But for the rest of the month, I don't have any load at all, for example, just very small loads. Or if I say, well, I'm just having a test environment and I do test one, like once every 2 days or something like that. So for those instances where I don't like have a nice stable load, but where I have, might have peaks or I might want to scale up over time, that's where serverless is awesome. And that's basically the difference on that. So let's have a look if there's more questions coming in. Like I said, if not, you can always contact me later on. So does it mean that serverless will have the best performance? Not necessarily. So the thing about serverless is if you want to have something that responds right away, no matter when, then serverless will not be the best option, because serverless, like I said, it will actually go into a sleeping state. So to get out of that sleeping state, it might mean that you have to wait for a couple of seconds. So if I want to execute a query and it's in a sleeping state, it actually has to spin up some resources for me, and that can take a couple of seconds. So this is, of course, fine. Like I said, if you are in a test environment, that won't be a problem. If you are running this, for example, if you are running a web store on this, I would probably not use serverless for my front-end facing queries. For my backend queries, that might be fine. Because my backend queries, I don't really care if that takes like 100 milliseconds or 2 seconds. So in that case, if it spins up and after it has spun up, it actually will it will spin up more resources when needed. So it depends on your scenario. Like I said, front-end facing, where there's actually a customer waiting on this or something like that, I would probably have something that is dedicated. Backend, I might probably want something that's serverless, because then I actually just pay as I go. But depending, of course, if I know, so if I already know, like I have a very stable load, then I would probably use dedicated. If I have like unpredictable load, then I would probably use something like serverless. So let's see if there's more questions coming in. But in the meantime, like I said, if you have any questions later on or you're just watching recording, feel free to contact me then on one of my social media things. I hope you enjoyed the session, by the way. I really love these reactor sessions, because it just allows me to share. Normally, when I do a session, it will be one session and it's just like the single session. And then after that, I cannot do anything more. But now, because I have 4 sessions, I can actually expand on different topics within the serverless space. And this I really enjoy. So I don't think there's more questions coming in. So I would like to say thank you, everyone. Next week, you're welcome again. Next week, we're going to talk about durable entities. So we are going to dive much more into functions. We already have seen functions in most of my sessions, but then we're actually going to see a lot more about functions, especially durable functions, durable entities. So we're going to have more about that. So for now, I would like to say thank you for being here. Enjoy the rest of your day, and I hope you have a great day. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much, Aldert, for another excellent session and very comprehensive demo. And thank you, everyone, for attending. Really hope to see you again at our final episode next week, same time. So, with that, I'll stop recording today's session. I dropped a link